So people might think as a science communicator that I'd be stuck behind a computer, but I found the most effective way to inspire people and encourage that wonder is to get hands-on with science. And I work here as programming coordinator in Spark Lab, Queensland Museum. I get to develop opportunities for our visitors to be the scientists, to be curious and make observations and ask questions about their world. I have the coolest job because I get to inspire the next generation of scientists. So science communication definitely empowers people to ask those big questions that might lead to the next big set of scientific discoveries. So that's what I love about my job. So something people don't realize is that everybody working here in Spark Lab has a science or education background. This expertise enables us to support our visitors with their STEM skills and thinking. My studies began with a degree in geology and then a research degree investigating carbon cycling in Arctic glacial environments. This is important because an enormous amount of carbon is stored in Arctic soils. The permafrost regions covered approximately 20% of the global land area, but contain up to 50% of global soil organic carbon stores. Climate change is leading to rising global temperatures, thawing the permafrost, and leading to the disappearance of glaciers and ice caps. These changes have the potential to change Arctic regions into a source of carbon and greenhouse gas emissions. But in order to accurately model it, we need to understand what's happening in the Arctic at the moment. My investigations focused on trying to understand the interactions and movement of nutrients, especially carbon, within glacial and periglacial environments, from the geosphere and the rocks, the cryosphere, the ice, to the hydrosphere, so the water, the atmosphere and the gases, to the biosphere, so the living things within those environments. I collected thousands of ice, water, rock, and soil samples over 2 6-month field expeditions. The analysis of these samples provided us with more information about the mobility of carbon within Arctic environments. It also led to a large interdisciplinary research project exploring nitrogen and phosphorus movements within these environments. Understanding this better will help us identify any changes to those emissions from these environments, and that's important if we want to predict and understand what might happen in the future. So I find inspiration in the scientific process. Here in Spark Lab, our scientific process begins by being curious and having a play, asking a question and testing out your ideas, observing what happens and talking to the people around you to see if you can come up with the next question to explore. Effective science communication allows people to see themselves as scientists, to recognize the science going on in the world all around them every day. I'm fascinated by nature, and I'm really intrigued by the field of biomimicry and design, so where the natural world serves as an inspiration for design and engineering. For example, NASA have been looking at gecko's feet, and that's been inspiring the next level of adhesives, or perhaps we'll go and have a look at trees and that will help improve bridge design. To do this kind of work, you can do some STEM subjects in high school and then go on to university to study science, communication or education. But you don't need a degree to do science. Why not get involved in some citizen science projects and then talk to your friends or family about the discoveries that you make? As a scientist, my hope for the future is that as a community, we'll see the value in asking questions, seeking answers, and making those new discoveries, because that's how we're going to make a difference. The ultimate question for me as a science communicator is how can we keep science relevant, interesting, and get everybody involved?